Straight Until Morning Hub, The Watchtower, Rating, Plus 33, Part 102, Foundation Orbital Research Compound 05, Keck, July 13, 1973, 0023 hours GMT. Sir, Lieutenant Mackey said, inputting a code into her consoles, they're hailing us. Cooper sighed, visual. Mackey shook her head, audio only. Turn down the alarms in here and put him on. This is Vladimir Vernetsky, Main Intelligence Directorate Division Psychotronics. I apologize for my brevity, but there's something wrong with my vessel. I am aware, as you are, that the Earth is gone. We are understanding orders to investigate your role in the disappearance. Unfortunately, my brethren have decided that this means your destructions. I am well aware that this will not bring us any information that we do not already know. Our battle plan is to fly our ships in close formation until we can engage with short-range weapons. We have already fired the kinetic impactors. You must stop them before they close the distance. I will try to help from here. Good luck. Fork, -05 actual, responding. Can you hear me? The signal's gone, sir. Mackey flicked another switch. I have multiple radar contacts. No more radio contacts, though we're hailing across all frequencies with multiple organization codes. Ensign Jennings, Director Cooper turned away. Reboot the SIS computers and make sure they're fully operational. We can't have them fucking up on us like the last live-fire exercise. Yes, sir. Give me 10 minutes and we'll be able to shoot anything they throw our way out of the sky, Jennings replied, before hurrying out of the room. Colonel, Cooper stopped as the man stepped forward. I need you and your prototypes out there. We'll synchronize our fire control data as soon as possible, but I want your birds in the air immediately. Yes, sir, Colonel Leonard replied, snapping his hand up to salute. Cooper would have laughed at the absurdity, but the man was about to put his life on the line for them all, so he nodded and smiled instead. Foundation Orbital Research Compound 05, Hangar Bay 4, July 13, 1973, 0035 hours GMT. Colonel Leonard breathed slowly and evenly in the thick fluid of his ship's crammed command bridge. Through the murk of the perfluorocarbon gel, intended to protect them against high accelerations, he could see his crew, hunched over partially installed control panels. Of Diamond, his engines ignited, and the ship flew out of the hangar, followed shortly by its sister ships. They accelerated with ponderous grace. No one had expected to be using the experimental countermeasure vessel testbeds in any serious capacity, and their engines weren't entirely designed for the weight of the armaments they carried. While there's currently no direct need for a designated combat space vessel, the DCVP prototypes provide a useful testbed for future microgravity combat technologies. Leonard tapped his comm console, Ace of Diamonds, hangar clear. Captain Wesker, King of Clubs, hangar clear. Queen of Spades, hangar clear. Captain Jennifer Jackson, their newest pilot, reported. Woo! Came the familiar and completely inappropriate voice of Captain John O'Neill. Jack of Hearts here, hangar clear. Leonard chuckled, then tapped his console again. Jack, calm it down a bit. We've got hostiles incoming. King, you've got Quadrant 1, Queen, you've got 2, Jack, you've got 3 and I've got 4. Enemy approach is along a polar orbit from planetary north, above the ecliptic, so we'll be supplementing the SIS in the top hemisphere. Be ready to shift if needed to the bottom half of your quadrant. Don't push your coils too hard, and remember that we still haven't quite nixed those coolant loop issues. Good hunting. A round of confirmations filtered through the open channel. Leonard looked down at his targeting computer and began to analyze the data. 20 large projectiles, too fast to be missiles, too big to be kinetic impactors. Only 2 ships, thankfully. The weapons were going to arrive in 25 minutes, the ships in an hour. Maybe an hour and a half if they were lucky. 54,451 kilometers from Fork, -05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 0055 hours GMT. They burned out to a significant distance, dropping chaff clouds on the most likely approaches and warming up their coils. Now, they waited. Leonard had always believed firmly in the old platitude that combat is boredom punctuated by brief moments of terror. The best he could hope for was more boredom, but terror, according to the data pouring in from the 4DCVPS apostrophe redomes, was already on the way. Leonard caught a slide violet outside the bridge's tiny portal. His eyes went wide as the flash of light was followed shortly by the sensors registering an impactor exploding violently as it encountered the chaff swarm. He allowed himself a momentary internal smile as the violet flashes lit up the sky in front of him, and then the tracks on the computer screen began to bend. All ships, these things are changing course. Fall back and prepare for intercept of guided missiles in Quadrant 4. The helmsman pulled back on the control stick, the fluid at the bridge swirling as the bow-heavy vessel swung around, attitude thrusters flaring. They matched the trajectories of the projectiles, nuclear engine burning cherry red. He hadn't thought that impactors this large could be so agile, but they were now actively avoiding his chaff cloud. If he was lucky, they'd caught the first one before it had fragmented. He wasn't counting on it, though. One question still rang in his mind. How were they being guided? 8 light seconds from fork, minus 05. Interplanetary space. July 13, 1973, 055 hours GMT. Vladimir Vernetsky looked at the other Vladimir Vernetskys and frowned. The apparitions surrounding him moved from station to station, preparing for the grim work ahead of them. The engines began to stutter. Vladimir knew that without a connection to Earth their energy reserve was limited, but the rest of his crew did not care. They'd set course for a close pass on the Foundation station, and they'd get one shot. The howling deep inside his ship intensified. If he couldn't stop this, one shot was all they'd need. Worse yet, if the Foundation couldn't stop the missiles already flying ahead of them, it wouldn't matter. The Global Occult Coalition, the Foundation, someone was going to need to help them when the ships finally shut down. His degrading fellows didn't understand that. All they had left to them was confusion and rage. 54,420.05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 0055 GMT. It is unclear how GRUP vessels target or launch these weapons. Their irregular design does not seem to impact their ballistic effectiveness. V-13 opened his eyes for the first time. V-20 had just exploded. There was an invisible wall in front of them, but he knew the solution. They'd go around it. He could feel the ships around him. 18 of his brothers and 4 of the others. The others would be the problem. V-13 chanted to himself, bringing the comm he needed to redirect his cage. The spirit energies behind him ignited and he directed him on a new path. A small cloud of metal tore towards him, but he evaded it with contemptuous ease. It would take longer to kill these thieves, but they would still die. 52,679 kilometers from fork, minus 05. High Earth TH-1973-159 GMT. I've got multiple encounters, Captain Olnayer, for the first time since Leonard had met him, sounded worried. Gunner's having trouble getting enough metal in the air. I'm starting to think these guys are a little smarter than a guided missile, sir. Leonard grunted as he tracked the firing solution on the nearest target. The tops had coiled and sprang to life, firing a spread of tungsten at his target. He was rewarded with a small flash of light. Wesker had managed to kill 3 clusters, but his weapons systems had overloaded during the last engagement, leaving his ship dead in space. Jackson's tally was 7 clusters and rising. Lenair was still struggling to shape the 5 clusters that had decided that it was their target, and not the other way around. None of them were fragmented yet. Leonard's tally was 4. That left 1 cluster unaccounted for. Small red warning lights had started to flicker on the master console each time he altered course. Queen, he said, punching his comm. Yes, sir. Jackson's voice answered in his ear. Go help Jack. The minute those things decide to break off, we're screwed. What about the last target? I'll handle it. Leonard's telemetry indicated the last target was headed straight for the base. Bring us around. Throttle to full. 34,502 kilometers from fork, minus 05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 159 GMT. V-13 was alone now. His fellows were all lost or stupidly pursuing the wrong targets. He was the only one who knew the true enemy. The Foundation and their evil would be eradicated. His pursuer was gaining on him though. How was that possible? He tried to increase his velocity, but he felt drained. The energy. His energy. It was gone. He closed his eyes again and flew apart in a rage. Suddenly a single kinetic impactor became 100 probar-sized missiles in an ever-widening constellation. 6 light seconds from fork, minus 05. Interplanetary space. July 13, 1973, 125 hours GMT. Vladimir Vernetsky looked over the weapons officer's shoulder. He felt the energy that fueled these copies waning. This copy of him didn't seem to care about anything anymore but the range indicator, which showed, to Vladimir, an uncomfortably small number. He passed his hand through the spirit's abdomen and grabbed at something invisible. The hat man disappeared. Vernetsky stepped forward and pressed several buttons. The gamma ray emitter targeting system found Purchase, the ship next to them. He fired, and a slight buzz reverberated. Straight until morning.